Okay, so in this lecture, we are going to continue our discussion on the topic of process synchronization. Though we name the topic as process synchronization, but it is synchronization of threads as well. So in the last chapter, we discussed concepts regarding inter-process communication. We understood how and why processes communicate. Processes communicate because majority of the times you processes need to exchange data. And we saw different kinds of inter-process communication mechanisms. Either they used shared memory or they used pipes or message passing. But these are all mechanisms to communicate. Okay. But inter-process communication also has its own set of challenges. And one of the major challenges that you have is when you are dealing with shared data or shared data structure. Now, think about a situation where suppose there is a shared memory, and this shared memory is used for inter-process communication between two processes, P1 and P2, and this is the shared memory. We have already seen that process P1 may write into this memory and process P2 may read from the memory. And this is how the two processes will communicate. But the problem is that if in this shared memory, you use such a variable where the variable or we may say some data or data structure is a shared data structure. That is, P1 is also doing something on that, P2 is also doing something on that. If this is the situation where a data or a data structure is shared by P1 and P2, and both of them can do some operation on that, there is a problem that can happen. And the problem is that you will not be able to know what is the final value of that particular data. This problem is called race condition. Why do we have this problem? We have this problem because whether P1 will be executing or P2 will be executing is not decided by the user, but decided by the scheduler. So if you look at the order in which P1 and P2 will be executing, it will be P1, P2, P1, P2, or it could be P2, P1, P2, P1. And these two order will create different values of the shared data. If P1 and P2 are sharing some data or some variable, let's say X, then if you follow this order, you will have a different value of X. And if you follow this order, you will have a different value of X. This is the problem that we are trying to address. So processes in which order will they execute is decided by the scheduler, not by the user, not by the programmer. So the scheduler, this does it according to its own rule. So that is the reason why the user doesn't know whether this process, this order will be executed or this order will be executed. If you execute this order, maybe the shared data, which is here, let's say X is somewhere here in this shared memory, both are writing something to that. Both are updating their own copies. So at the end of the entire computation of P1 and P2, you cannot deterministically say what is the final value of X. It can be X1, it can be X2, it can be anything. This is the problem that we are talking about, and this is called the race condition. So there is or there has to be some kind of synchronization between the processes which are handling such shared data or data structure. It is mandatory. You require that. And this is the whole idea of this topic called synchronization. we call it synchronization, or sometimes you come across a topic called concurrency. The idea is this, that whenever we have shared data or shared data structure and multiple processors are using that, there has to be some kind of synchronization, some kind of a rule to tell me that what should be the order. Because I need to know what is the final value of that particular shared data or data structure. This is what we are going to talk about in this course. We will first of all motivate ourselves for synchronization, the problem that I was discussing. We will formulate this problem into a more, you know, mathematical way, and we will call that as the critical section problem. Critical section means the section which is critical for execution. The section of the code which has that shared data or data structure. We are not interested in what exactly is getting updated, whether it is a table or a buffer or a variable or an array. We are putting that into one group and calling it to be a critical section, the section which is shared by multiple processes. It is not important what gets updated. It's important that how do you protect that particular section. So we are going to generalize that and call it critical section problem. Then we will see a lot of software solutions for them. We'll also look at the hardware solutions for them. And then we will finally end up into the most popular solution for these concurrency type of problems called semaphores. We will also see different codes related to semaphores. And we shall see some practical problems based on the synchronization problem. The three most practical problems or the most common problems in computer science which requires solutions for synchronization. And we will finally end up with the discussion on programming language based solution called monitors. This is what this chapter is all about. Okay, we have already discussed there's a requirement of synchronization because accesses, concurrent processes would try to access shared data. And if you do that, there can be inconsistency. Inconsistency means you do not know what is the final value of the shared data. So there has to be a deterministic result. You cannot have ambiguity or non-determinism. How do you handle this problem? Now, maintaining data consistency requires mechanism to ensure orderly execution. So this is the main, you know, requirement of concurrency. You have to decide on one fixed order. You cannot have, oh, this can be this way, this can be an order, this can be an order. No, there can be only one order. You decide the order. So there will be some rules which will be decided for establishing this order. We will start off our discussion with three motivating scenarios. We will first look at two threads which are updating a shared variable. Then we will see two processes which are attempting a concurrent access. And finally, we will see the bounded buffer problem. Let us begin with the two threads updating the shared variable. We have seen that. It is just a quick recap to give you an idea what is the inconsistency problem we are talking about. So the problem that we have here is this. We have two processes or two threads which are updating a shared variable. The shared variable that we are using is called counter, let's say, and it is of type integer and initialized with a value of 5. Here is thread 1 that is performing an increment operation on the shared variable. and this is, please ignore this, thread 2 is doing a decrement operation on the shared data. This is the situation that we have. Thread 1 is going to increment, thread 2 is going to decrement. You can call it process or thread, whatever. And as you see here, this is the way in which the processes are scheduled. 1, then 2, then 1, then 2. And you are asked, what is the final value of the count? If you try to do that, let's see the situation. Three situations arise, and these have been depicted in these three tables. What you see here is, this is the initial value of the shared variable, which is 5. Now, there can be three scheduling patterns. We don't know. The scheduler can decide any one of the pattern. If the scheduling pattern is scheduling pattern 1, by the way, now these three statements, they represent the operation counter plus plus. These three are three assembly instructions. If you remember, each high-level instruction ultimately gets translated into an assembly instruction. The compiler does it. And the instructions that actually get executed on the CPU are the assembly instructions. So let us assume that counter plus plus is equivalent to these three. And these are three simple assembly instructions where if a variable has to be updated, first, it is loaded onto a temporary register. Then the register gets updated. And then the updated register result is loaded back to the variable. This is the idea. So counter is first loaded onto register R1. R1 is updated. And then it is loaded back to counter. So these are the three statements that represent counter plus plus. Similarly, these are the three statements that represent counter minus minus. This again is the same. The count value of counter is loaded onto register R2. R2 is decremented and then loaded back to counter. Now, if this scheduling pattern follows the first three, then the next three, you know that this is ultimately 6. And then after this, there's a decrement and you get back to 5. So if you start with 5, these three, after you execute these three, you get the value of R1 to be 6 or counter to be 6. And then if you follow these three, you decrement the value from 6 back to 5. Context switch is when you are shifting from process P1 to process P2. This is the meaning. Context switch is the term to represent that now the scheduling has been done and now process P2 starts. But these six statements can come in any order. It is not necessary that the first three will follow the next three, no. As you see in scheduling pattern 2, this is the instruction that gets executed. And here, as you see, that R1 in this particular case is 5. I start with 5. Then there are three instructions which happen. Again, there is a counter which was initially, so R2 here has the initial value of counter, which is 5. Then R2 gets decremented, R2 becomes 1 less, which is 4. And then counter becomes the current value of R2, which is 4. But then there's again a context switch, and you again come back from P2 to P1. You might come back from P1 to P2. And in P1, you resume these two instructions, which is R1 increments itself. R1 was initially 5, so it increments to 6, and counter gets loaded with the latest value of R1, which is 6. So the counter value is 6. Just the opposite happens if you had scheduling pattern 3, where you start with R2 updation and you end up with counter being updated by the latest value of R2. So here R2 is 5. These three after execution will result in counter value equal to 6, but when these resume, the last value of R2 was 5, which is 4 in this case, and counter becomes 4. So what we find is that three different ordering of the instructions results in three different values of the counter. And most importantly, because it's an absolutely jumbled pattern, the instructions which last updates counter is the value that is shown. This is the problem of.
So why is this happening? Means why is this randomness in the scheduling pattern there?
It's not happening. It can be in any one of these three possibilities, because a scheduler can schedule it according to this pattern. A scheduler can schedule it according to this pattern, or it can follow pattern number three. We do not know in which particular pattern the scheduler will be scheduling that.
Yes, sir. That is what I am saying. That for example, if we were printing some output, then at that time also we saw that sometimes the output came different according to the scheduling being done. Exactly something like this would have happened there also. So why is this happening?
It can happen. We are not interested in that, but it should not happen if you are using a shared variable. The trouble is there. Definitely, the processes always execute according to the decision of the scheduler. But if both the process, they are using the shared variable, and then if this happens, then you are in trouble, because you cannot then decide what will be the output of the shared variable. This is the motivation of this problem. Now think that P1 is a process that is updating counter, incrementing that, and P2 is a process that is decrementing that. And if these things happen in this way, so program P1 is incrementing a shared variable counter and program P2 is decrementing a shared variable counter. Now, if you follow scheduling pattern 1, your final result of counter is 5. If you are following scheduling pattern 2, your final value of counter is 6. And if you are following scheduling pattern 3, your final value of counter, which is the shared variable, is the final value is 4. Now the question is, should you allow this kind of all possibilities of the counter variable? It's not possible. Why? Because if I have to write a program based on something, based on which, I mean, if I'm going to write a program where I will be deciding on the output of the counter variable, what is the value that I will get? I don't know. I may get 5, I may get 6, I may get 4. You cannot write a program with this kind of ambiguity. You need to have a definite value for that. This is the problem we are talking about. If you allow a shared data, there can be this kind of problem, because the scheduling can happen in any possible way. Does it answer to your question?
Yes, sir, to a certain extent.
Okay. Now, there's one more motivating example that we have covered. And this is the problem which we call the bounded buffer problem. We've already seen this. This is the problem that we have. In the previous case, we were talking about a data. Here it is a data structure. It's a queue, or you can say a buffer, where the producer is a process which is producing items, and consumer is the process which is consuming items. So this is the item which is produced, and this is consumed by the consumer. In order to maintain the same rate, producer is producing items and consumer is consuming items. Think about a situation where producer is producing and keeping them in a buffer, and consumer is consuming them from the buffer. If producer and consumer are not operating at the same rate, someone is faster, someone is slower, then there is a problem. The problem is that producer will be producing items faster, consumer will be not able to consume them. in that case, the buffer will be gradually filling up. The buffer will gradually fill up, isn't it? The buffer will be filled up by the items produced by the producer. But you don't want to do that. You want the two things to be synchronized. We will talk about that later. So currently the situation is, if the buffer is of infinite size, then you don't have a problem, because there is infinite locations available. Producer can produce items and all of them will be kept in that buffer. So there will be absolutely no problem. Even if producer is producing items very fast, you have space, you will be keeping them one by one in the buffer. And consumer will be consuming that when it gets time. Problem is, if the buffer is not unbounded, that is, the buffer is bounded, it has a limit. So if you have a limited buffer, then when the producer will be producing items and the consumer is not able to consume, gradually the buffer will start getting filled up. And when the buffer will be completely filled, the producer will not be able to produce any more item. So producer has to wait. Similarly, if the consumer is consuming things very fast and the producer is not producing items so fast, so the rate at which producer is producing and the consumer is consuming, if the consumer is consuming faster, then gradually this will become empty. Think about a tap which is delivering water in a tank, and there is one outlet which is through which the water is moving out. Now, if the rate of both delivery and inlet and outlet is same, you will have no water. Okay, so it's a constant quantity of water that will be maintained. But if it is not, then either the water level will start slowly getting filled up if the inlet is having a more rate, and if the outlet rate is more, then your water will drain out faster and you'll gradually see the water towards an empty tank. That's the problem here. So the producer will have to wait if there is no more place to keep the next item. So that means the entire buffer is filled. That's the check that the producer will make. And the consumer will make a check that whether the buffer is empty. If the buffer is empty, it has nothing to consume, so it has to wait. So these are the two things that the producer and the consumer will be checking. This is what we have written in the form of a producer code and a consumer code. The producer code is producing an item and it is checking whether it has reached the maximum. Similarly, the consumer is consuming the item and is checking whether it is empty. In and out are two pointers which we are maintaining for pointing by the producer, and out is the pointer which is maintained by the consumer for keeping track of what is the current state of the buffer. It is a fine solution, but there's a problem with this. The problem with this solution is this solution only allows n minus 1 items in the buffer. So what we do is we add a variable called counter and we initialize that to 0. So counter will be keeping track of how many items the producer has produced and how many items the consumer has consumed. It will keep track of the number of slots in the buffer. That's it. The slots in the buffer, you can think in terms of an empty slot or full slot. Some may call it, okay, I want to find out how many slots are full. And the other way of seeing that problem is, I may say how many slots are empty. Both are okay. Let's try to use this solution. So we are going to use a counter variable. And interestingly, this is a shared data. Look at the data what are the data items that are shared? Number one, a variable called n, which is keeping track of the number of the size of the buffer. Most importantly, a variable called counter, which is shared. So both the producer code and the consumer code will be using this variable counter. We will use something called item. You can think item to be of any data type, whatever item the producer code is producing. And a buffer, which is the array. Yes, the array is also a shared data structure. because it is used by both producer and consumer. So the counter variable is our shared data. The item is a shared data structure. The buffer is a shared data structure, and the in-out pointers, they are also shared. So these are the things. Buffer is identified by this in-out. So there. Now let's have a look at the producer code. Producer code says while one means always on, always do something. What? Produce an item. Keep it in a variable called next p, and check whether the counter has become n or not. Yes, that's the check that producer should do. Whether the counter has become n, that means has the counter reached to the end of the buffer? If the counter is keeping track of the current state of the empty slot, if it is n, that means there is no empty slot now. If there is no empty slot, there is no place for my item to be placed. So what to do? The producer will do nothing. No operation. So look at this while loop. If this while is true, you are doing nothing. Okay. If it is true, if this counter is equal to n, do nothing. Okay. That's the check. If the counter is not equal to n, well, the next p which holds the item will be placed in the buffer. Which element of the buffer? The given by the value of in. Then increment in, increment counter, and go over to the next iteration. This is what the producer does. What does the consumer supposed to do? Same thing, except that it checks whether the counter is zero. If the counter is zero, that means no item in the buffer, so no operation. If there is any item, well, whatever be the current value of out in that particular location of the buffer, you kept the next C. So the current value of data which is in this buffer will be put into next C, and then you consume. Consume means this next C value will be used in the further computation. Decrement the counter, increment the out, and next iteration. The problem is very, very similar to the thread, the counter problem that we have already discussed. It's again the same, because the counter is getting incremented in the producer process and is getting decremented in the consumer process. It is the same kind of problem. Because it's a shared data, where the counter is getting incremented and decremented, you can have the same problem where you can have any ordering. Let us assume that I started off with a counter equal to 10. After I have the producer and consumer, I don't know what is the value of counter. It can be 9, it can be 10, it can be 11. Because this counter plus 1 and counter minus 1 can get executed in any order and eventually lead to a race condition. This is the problem that we are talking about. Solution to this problem. Solution is, you ensure only one process can manipulate the shared data at a time. This is the solution that we have. Only one process is allowed to touch that data or data structure. If you know which process is touching that, you know what execution will happen. You know what output will come. And this is called mutual exclusion. Ensuring this particular condition is called mutual exclusion, exclusively applied for different processes. Only one will be allowed. As a practical example of this concept, we see here, this is a spool. Spool is, you can say, a queue maintained by the printer, where the printer is getting the different files which should be printed. Now there is a queue one by one that gets filled. Currently, the process which will provide the file should come and sit in location number 7 of this queue. But the problem is that both process A and process B both are trying to send their respective files. Process A is going to send a file F1, process B is going to send a file F2. Now this particular location of the queue is the shared data structure. This queue is the shared data structure, and this location of this array that is updated by either process A or process B. Now, if this particular process A or process B, they also happen to work in the same interleaved way, and there is allocation of the file is also some program. This program also has three lines. And if you happen to execute in this way, that process A executes the first line and it is taken out. There's a context switch here. And then process B goes through all the three lines. Process B completes all the three lines. So process B has put its file into location number 7. But before it could print, but before the printer could print that, there's a context switch again. And after this context switch, again process A resumes, and process A now completes the rest of these two instructions. And what happens is process A overwrites that location 7 with its own file, which means process B did not get a chance to get printed. Process B's file will not be printed. That's it. Again, the same problem. So this is the race condition that we are talking about, which has to be handled. So what is the solution? This is the problem that was formally defined by Dijkstra's in 1965, and he called this problem as the critical section problem. And formally, the problem is like this. This is the formal definition of this critical section problem, which says that if your system has n processes, let's say P0 to Pn minus 1, total n number of processes you have, and each process has a particular code, there is a segment in the code. So P1 is a process, let's say some program. There is a particular section in this particular code which has a data or a data structure, and that data and data structure is shared by another process, P2. P2 also has a particular section in its code which also contains that data, let's say that count variable. So there is a particular segment of code which is called critical section. Why? Because in this particular section, the process is sharing something with other processes. There can be a shared data or a data structure which is also present in other processes, same thing, some global data structure. So that particular portion of the code of each individual process is a very critical part. You have to give a special attention to that. That is why Dijkstra called it the critical section. And the critical section can be handling of a variable, it can be a table, it can be a file, it can be a buffer, anything. And by the way, you can have several critical sections in your code. I am written one part, it doesn't mean there can be several critical sections in a code. So on a particular process may have several critical sections, and you should be aware that every critical section contains either a variable, table, file. It is sharing with other processes. So other processes will also be updating that particular data. So it's very, very important to protect. That means to ensure who gets a chance to use that particular data. So what Dijkstra said is, if you want to correctly use this, then the execution of the critical section must be mutually exclusive. That's what he said. You cannot allow all processes to execute on that critical section at the same time. You have to allow only one process to execute them. So formally, the solution to the critical section problem was that we have to design a protocol. Protocol means rule. It's the meaning of protocol is rule. You have to come up with a rule that the processes can use so that they can only allow one process to be executed in the critical section. The question is, each process will be requesting to enter the critical section. It has to request. It's not that anybody can execute. No. If there are n candidates who want to execute in the critical section, one of them will be allowed. So there is a formal procedure for that. What we are going to talk about. So this request is ensured by a section in the code called the entry section. We will talk about that. And this additional code that you are adding to the existing problem will ensure that only one process will be allowed. Either that particular process or some other process will be allowed. And finally, there is also another section in the code which is called exit section, which will ensure that once a particular process is done with handling the critical section, it should allow others to come in. It is like that when I'm done with my job, you are at the counter. Your counter of the canteen, and there's only one counter. Let's say you have gone to some mall or something, and where you are ordering some food, and you have come to the counter, only one person can stand at the counter. That's the rule. So when your order has been placed, you take the order and you leave the space so that the next person who's in the queue can come and place the next order. That's the rule. So there must be an exit section. Okay. But all the solutions to the critical section problem that we will be looking at in just a moment, they have to follow these three conditions. So any solution, and please understand these three solutions very, very clearly. If you have any problem anywhere, feel free to ask me. We will be looking at four algorithms, and every algorithm will be analyzed on the basis of these three requirements. I'm going to explain each one of them now. So if you have a solution, if you come up with a solution, the solution must follow these three requirements. What are they? Number one, mutual exclusion. What is the condition? If any process PI is executing in its critical section, then no other process can be executing in the critical section. It means, suppose I have a process P1 which is having some code, and here is the critical section of the code. I have another process P2, which is also some code, and it also has the critical section. Now, remember, this critical section uses some variable, let's say some variable C, that is present in both P1 and P2, and both of them are updating something on C. So what is mutual exclusion properties? What does it say? It says that at any point of time, only one process will be working with C. What is meant by one? Now I know that sometimes P1 will get executed, sometimes P2, because this will happen. P2 will get executed, P3 will get executed, P4 will get executed. Scheduler, no, not P4, let's for timing, let's concentrate on only one, two, and then we'll, so P1, then P2, then P1, then P2. Scheduler will do it in this way. Now, what do I mean by mutual exclusion? Think in this way. Suppose scheduler has currently started executing P1. So P1 executed this line, then this line, then this line, that came here. And P1 started executing on C. P1 started executing on C. Got it? Okay. That means P1 is currently executing the critical section. P1 is executing the critical section. Suddenly, P1 is taken out. There's a context switch and P1 is taken out. If P1 is taken out, P2 gets a chance to execute. P2 starts its execution. It executes this line, this line, this line, and reaches the critical section portion of the code and says, I now want to execute critical section. I now want to execute critical section. Now see the problem. If you allow P2 to execute in the critical section, right, and P2 updates the value of C, when P1 will resume, what will P1 see? P1 will see a different value of C. P1 will find, array, I did not update that. मैंने तो ये C का value किया नहीं था. फिर ये नया value कहाँ से आ गया? ये यहाँ से आया. P2 ने उसको update कर दिया. तो फिर P1 will ask, भाई आपने P2 को allow ही क्यों किया? That's the problem. So you should stop P2 to get executed. P2, as long as you are not executing the critical section, कोई problem नहीं है. आप ये कर लो, ये कर लो, ये कर लो. यहाँ वाला कोड अगर आप एग्जीक्यूट कर रहे हो विल नॉट बी अलाउड. यू विल नॉट बी अलाउड टू एग्जीक्यूट दिस. व्हाई यू विल नॉट बी अलाउड टू एग्जीक्यूट दिस? बिकॉज देयर इज ऑलरेडी सम पर्सन और सम प्रोसेस P1 व्हिच वाज एग्जीक्यूटिंग. इट हैज नॉट फिनिश्ड. इट वाज जस्ट टेकन आउट. बिफोर इट कुड कम आउट ऑफ दिस सेक्शन इट वाज टेकन आउट ऑफ इट्स एग्जीक्यूशन. सो इट वाज ऑलरेडी एग्जीक्यूटिंग दैट. सो यू आर नॉट अलाउड. यू कुड You will get blocked. This is the meaning of mutual exclusion. You will not allow more than one process to execute the critical section. You have to ensure that. So, do something that even if P2 reaches during its execution to this, until P1 has finished, P1 has been taken out from execution, P1 is sitting in the ready queue, it is waiting. P2 is executing, but P2, when it is executing, cannot execute this critical section because P1 has not yet come out. So P1 will get blocked. Sorry, P2 will get blocked. Go do this part, but this part you will not be allowed to do until P1 releases. Do something so that this happens. It could have been other way around. Had P2 first reached the critical section and it was working there and then it was taken out, P1 was given a chance. P1 will be blocked if P1 wants to enter before P2 has come. This is the idea of mutual exclusion. Second, the second requirement is called progress. Deadlock freedom.
Sir, in mutual exclusion, doesn't it take more time than required?
No, it's not that. There are reasons. We'll see. Wait. So the second requirement, yeah.
Sir, if I want to use the value of the variable which are shared at some point of time, and I am assuming that means up till now the variable is updated. But what if the scheduler has decided the another algorithm? Although we are preventing, although we are using that mutual exclusion, then what?
Another algorithm means?
नहीं मतलब सर मैं ये बोलना चाह रहा हूँ कि अगर हमारा जो कोड है मेन कोड ठीक है, अगर उसमें मैं ये जो शेड वेरिएबल है उसको उसकी वैल्यू में यूज़ करना चाह रहा हूँ ठीक है, और तो मैं ये मानूंगा कि अब तक तो कैलकुलेट हो जाना चाहिए था मीन्स दोनों दोनों थ्रेड से P1 और P2 से, बट ये जो हमने जो म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन का किया तो उससे वो लेट भी हो सकता है तो मेरे को रियल वैल्यू नहीं मिलेगी ना?
नहीं, रियल वैल्यू क्यों नहीं मिले? वो लेट हो सकता है, उसके तरीके हैं हैंडल करने के, वो आ रहे हैं, डोंट वरी, वो दिखाया जाएगा आपको कैसे करते हैं. वो हो सकता है, ये प्रॉब्लम हम डिस्कस करेंगे कैसे वो प्रोसेसेस के प्रायोरिटी के ऊपर डिपेंड करेगा. ये सही तरीका नहीं है, इसके भी अच्छे अच्छे तरीके हैं. तो कैसे म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन को अच्छे प्रॉब्लम में हैंडल किया था वो बताया जाएगा, डोंट वरी. प्रॉब्लम समझ में आएगी. दैट्स द आइडिया कि क्या करना है, कि यू हैव टू अलाउ ओनली वन प्रोसेस टू बी एग्जीक्यूटेड. यू कैन नॉट अलाउ मल्टीपल प्रोसेसेस टू बी देयर इन द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन. शेड्यूलिंग होते रहेंगे, प्रोसेसेस आना जाना लगा रहेगा. कभी कोई प्रोसेस चल रहा था, अचानक उससे खींच लिया जाएगा, दूसरे प्रोसेस को एग्जीक्यूट करने दिया जाएगा. लेकिन इसका मतलब ये नहीं है कि दूसरा प्रोसेस एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा है तो अचानक वो क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में चला गया तो उसे अलाउ कर दिया जाए. नहीं भाई, उसे रोक दिया जाएगा वहाँ पे. आप बाकी कोड कर लो, वो पोर्शन आप नहीं कर सकते क्योंकि पिछले वाले केस कोई प्रोसेस था आपसे पहले, वो एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा था और उसने क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे वो एंटर कर चुका है लेकिन बेचारा बाहर नहीं निकला, तो उसका काम चल रहा है, आप अभी अंदर नहीं जा सकते। आप एग्जीक्यूट कर रहे हो अच्छी बात है, लेकिन वहां नहीं कर सकते, वहां आपको रोक दिया जाए। जब तक पिछले वाला जो प्रोसेस है उसे चांस मिले एग्जीक्यूट होने का और वो अपना काम क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे कंप्लीट कर ले, क्योंकि तो अगर वो नहीं
और
करेगा तो पता कैसे चलेगा कि क्या आने वाला है। यही तो स्टोरी है कि हमें डिटर्मिनिस्टिकली पता होना चाहिए कि क्रिटिकल सेक्शन जब कंप्लीट होता है तो उस वेरिएबल का वैल्यू क्या होना चाहिए। अगर हमें पता है कि P1 ही है जो कंप्लीट करेगा क्रिटिकल सेक्शन को, तो हमें पता होगा कि P1 क्या करने वाला है। अगर आपने दोनों को अलाउ कर दिया तो पता कैसे चलेगा कि भाई फाइनल रिजल्ट होगा क्या। कहानी ये
सर व्हाट इफ द पीवन सर मतलब क्रिटिकल सिचुएशन से बाहर ही ना आए, मीन्स अंदर इनफिनाइट
हो
लूप जैसे
सकता
कुछ हो
है,
जाए, तो
हाँ हो सकता है, ऐसा हम
फिर
देखेंगे,
उसके लिए क्या करेंगे?
करेंगे, आ रहे हैं सॉल्यूशन पे धीरे धीरे। पहले कहानी को बिल्डअप करने दो, आ रहे हैं उस पे। ऐसा हो सकता है, एब्सोल्युटली हो सकता है, हम देखेंगे। और ये प्रॉब्लम हुआ भी था, इसकी एक केस स्टडी हम डिस्कस करेंगे। मार्स पाथफाइंडर का एक प्रॉब्लम था जहाँ पे मार्स में भेजा गया था एक रोवर, और जो से वहाँ पे पिक्चर्स कलेक्ट करके वापस भेजना उसका काम था, लेकिन ऐसा एक कुछ हो गया था जहाँ पे उसका एक टास्क जो है बेचारा वो कभी एग्जीक्यूट ही नहीं कर पा रहा था क्योंकि तो उसको प्रायोरिटी नहीं मिल रही थी और वो क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में घुसा बैठा हुआ था। प्रोसेस की प्रायोरिटी होती है ना, तो जो सबसे लोअर
यस
प्रायोरिटी वाला टास्क है वो बेचारा क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में पहुंच गया, खत्म करने से पहले उसे खींच लिया गया क्योंकि वो हायर प्रायोरिटी टास्क वहां पहुंच गया। अब प्रॉब्लम ये हो गई कि वो हायर प्रायोरिटी टास्क चलता रह जा रहा है, चलता जा रहा है क्योंकि उसका प्रायोरिटी हाई है, और वो हाई प्रायोरिटी टास्क हमेशा क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में पहुंच रहा है, चांस नहीं मिल रहा है। क्यों नहीं मिल रहा? क्योंकि लो प्रायोरिटी टास्क वो अभी बाहर ही नहीं गया था क्रिटिकल सेक्शन से और उसे चांस नहीं मिल रहा एग्जीक्यूट होना। ये अजीब सा प्रॉब्लम हो गया था। हाई प्रायोरिटी टास्क को क्रिटिकल सेक्शन चाहिए लेकिन मिल नहीं रहा, क्यों? क्योंकि लो प्रायोरिटी टास्क बाहर ही नहीं निकला। क्यों नहीं बाहर निकला? क्योंकि लो प्रायोरिटी टास्क को कभी चांस ही नहीं मिल रहा एग्जीक्यूट होने का, कि बाकी वाला जो पोर्शन है क्रिटिकल सेक्शन का उसे खत्म तो कर लो, नहीं कर पा रहा है। क्यों नहीं कर पा रहा? क्योंकि वो लो प्रायोरिटी टास्क है, उसे शेड्यूलर चांस ही नहीं दे रहा। ये गड़बड़ हो गई थी मार्स पाथफाइंडर। और ये हो गया कि जैसे ही वो हाई प्रायोरिटी टास्क को क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में चांस नहीं मिल रहा है, वो बार बार शट डाउन कर दे रहा है, ऑन हो रहा है ऑफ हो रहा, ऑन हो रहा ऑफ हो रहा, पूरा पाथफाइंडर प्रोजेक्ट बेकार हो गया। ये प्रॉब्लम थी। देन द साइंटिस्ट ट्राई टू फाइंड आउट व्हाट एग्जैक्टली इज वाज गोइंग रॉन्ग एंड दे फाउंड दैट दिस इज द प्रॉब्लम। अ लो प्रायोरिटी टास्क वाज नेवर अलाउड टू एग्जीक्यूट बिकॉज इट वाज होल्डिंग द लॉक एंड द लॉक वाज नेवर रिलीज्ड एंड द हाई प्रायोरिटी टास्क वाज नेवर गेटिंग बैक द लॉक। Why? Because the low priority task was never getting a chance to get executed. That was the problem in Mars Pathfinder. Yes, it can be there. ये problem हो सकता है। We'll talk about that. इसे handle करने का एक तरीका है। There is a particular way to handle this problem, and then that was implemented in. This is the problem that happened in a particular operating system that was used, a real-time operating system. I'll talk about that case study. Second. Very important condition that has to be yes.
सर अगर कोई प्रोग्राम क्रिटिकल सेक्शन का कोई इंस्ट्रक्शन एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा है तो उस टाइम पे तो कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विच होना पॉसिबल है ना, मतलब उसके टाइम मतलब क्रिटिकल सेक्शन के टाइम में भी?
हाँ, इसीलिए तो वो उसको उसको गार्ड करना जरूरी होता है,
हाँ तो
इसीलिए तो
मतलब
गार्ड करना है। कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विचिंग हो जाता है इसीलिए तो गड़बड़ है। अगर कॉन्टेक्स्ट
जैसे
स्विचिंग हो
अगर
गया, दूसरे प्रोजेक्ट को मिल गया, दूसरे प्रोसेस को मिल गया, वो भी क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में पहुंच गया, तब तो गड़बड़ है, इसीलिए तो करना है। कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विचिंग हो, कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, होगा ही, तुम कुछ नहीं कर सकते। लेकिन अगर होता भी है तो डजंट मैटर
क्योंकि सर
कि
सेकंड प्रोसेस को हम जाने नहीं दे रहे उसको।
हाँ आप काम करो, सेकंड प्रोसेस में कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है, आप बाकी अपना जो जो उसको छोड़ के जो पोर्शन है उसको एग्जीक्यूट कर लो, लेकिन क्रिटिकल सेक्शन वाला आप नहीं कर सकते, ये आपको नहीं अलाउ किया जाएगा। ये कहानी, दिस इज वॉट इज म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन। इज दैट क्लियर?
यस सर,
ये समझना बहुत जरूरी है। दिस इज दिस प्रॉब्लम दैट यू शुड अंडरस्टैंड। व्हाई इज इट इंपॉर्टेंट दैट यू शुड स्टॉप दैट पर्टिकुलर प्रोसेस? Okay, the second requirement, progress. What is that? Well, it says if no progress is, no process is executing the critical section, and there exist some processes that wish to enter, then the selection will be entirely on the basis of who has asked to enter. It's like this. Now, there is a critical section, and suppose, let's say, P1 was executing. P1 was executing, but P1 doesn't want to enter critical section. So what it says is, if no process is executing in its critical section, so when you are looking at the part of the code of each process, you see that none of the process is executing in the critical section. They are executing the remainder code. मतलब P1 ये वाला कोड एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा होगा या इस वाला कोड एग्जीक्यूट, सिमिलरली P2 भी ये वाला कर रहा होगा, इस वाला, दोनों में से कोई क्रिटिकल सेक्शन वाला कोड एग्जीक्यूट नहीं कर रहे हैं, वो बाकी पोर्शन वाला कोड एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा है, व्हिच मींस इफ देयर इज अ P3 व्हिच इज आल्सो शेयरिंग दिस क्रिटिकल सेक्शन एंड नाउ व्हेन P3 गेट्स अ चांस टू एग्जीक्यूट इट एंड वांट्स टू एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन. सो इफ देयर आर नो अदर प्रोसेस which is in the critical section, and if there's a process that wants to enter the critical section, it should immediately be allowed. I repeat, if there's a process P1, on P1, P2, P3, let's say there are three processes which are executing in the system, they are scheduled, either P1 or P2 or P3. But when P1 and P2 are executing, they are not executing in the critical section. So the critical section is free. They are executing the remainder part. And when P3 is getting a chance, P3 wants to enter the critical section. So progress says, if there is no process in the critical section, and there is a process which wants to enter critical section, it should be immediately allowed. Now, what is the big deal in that? You may wonder, what is it? It's very common sense. No, it's not. It means that processes P1 and P2 should not disturb the entry of P3, because P1 and P2, remember, are not executing the critical section. If they are not executing the critical section, they should not take part in the decision that P3 should go in or not. P1 or P2 critical section execute nahi kar rahe hain, to wo nahi decide karenge ki P3 ko jana chahiye ya nahi jana chahiye. Haan. अगर कोई चौथा प्रोसेस है P4, वो भी क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे जाना चाहता है, तो डिसीजन सिर्फ P3 और P4 के बीच में होगी, उनके बीच में नहीं होगी जो क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में नहीं है या नहीं जाना चाहते हैं. प्रोसेसेस व्हिच आर नॉट गोइंग इनटू द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन शुड नॉट पार्टिसिपेट इन द डिसीजन प्रोसेस. अगर वो ऐसा करते हैं तो वो गलत है. ये प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट, ठीक है.
Sir, the variable or the like lock used to like figure out if a process is in the critical section or not, like in the previous example, the counter plus plus takes three lines of code, right? So the variable used to keep track of the critical section if a process is in it or not, that also take like multiple lines of codes. So like
No. We'll come to that. We'll come to that. That's a good question. That also, we'll first look at a software solution and then look at a hardware solution.
Okay.
Just wait for time. I'll come to that. Okay. We'll see the solutions. So as I told you, the selection of the processes that will enter the critical section cannot be postponed indefinitely. Means it will not be decided by the ones which are not taking part. It will only be between the processes which want to. And the third is called bounded waiting. Bounded waiting means if a process has executed its critical section, it comes out of the critical section. Again, it wants to enter critical section. Fine, give it a chance. Again, it comes out. Again, it wants to critical. So you cannot allow one particular process to go on entering and exiting. Why? Because if you go on doing that, then other processes who are waiting will never get a chance and they will starve. We call that starvation. So there must be an upper bound on the number of times that you are going to allow a particular process to execute in the critical section. You cannot be unfair. You cannot allow one particular execute in the critical section and others are not getting a chance. No, aisa nahi chalega. Sabko equal bari bari chance deni hai. This is called freedom from starvation.
Okay, so this was the solution which the scientists of the Mars Rover program came up with.
No, that was not this. There is a different different sort of problem. I'll come to that. The solution was using a variable called semaphores. We'll talk about that. So there's a problem with the priority. We'll see how the priority was given an elevation. This is the requirement. You cannot be unfair to a particular process. You have to give fair chance to everyone. Okay. But for this, there are some assumptions. Number one, each process will be executing at a non-zero speed. Okay. Every process will take some amount of time. That is the most important thing. And no assumptions on the relative speed of n processes. We are not concerned with the speed at which these things. These are the two assumptions that we are making. So these are the three conditions that any solution to a critical section problem must have: mutual exclusion, progress, bounded weight. With this idea, let's attempt our first solution. I hope all of you by this time will be able to, you know, appreciate this diagram. Process A was executing some piece of code. This is the normal code. Then there's a critical section in process A. Process A has entered critical section because there was no one else in the system who wanted. A started. This is the gray line. Then there was a context switch. B started. B executed some piece of the code, non-critical section code. And once it reaches T2, then B also said that I want to enter critical section. But it was stopped. Why? Because A is currently executing the critical section, so you should not allow B. B gets blocked. Then when A resumes, A completes its critical section solution, critical section execution, and A leaves the critical section. When A leaves, then B is given a chance to enter the critical section and proceed. Okay. And as you have rightly said, will this delay the process? Yes, it will delay the process. We'll see how we can overcome this problem. There are different solutions to handle that. So let us try to work out a solution.
One second, sir. Sir, in the previous slide at the T2, sir, will there be any pause and resume for the process A?
Will there be?
Will there be any pause or resume for the process A? Means that when the B is coming and wanting to enter in the critical situation, but at that time
we will not be allowed. We will come to that particular execution code and will not be allowed. It will be put to sleep. Okay, it will be put to sleep. The moment it will be put to sleep, it will be taken out of execution and A will be given a chance to execute on the CPU. So A will complete the rest of the instructions. This is how
means mere ko just ye puchna hai ki matlab momentarily matlab a kuch seconds ke liye rukega kya jab matlab jaise b chahega ki main enter karu a ko thoda
sa b to b to already execute kar hi raha tha
ha
b to execute kar hi raha tha jab aap usne usko schedule kiya gaya hai b to execute kar hi raha tha a to tha hi nahi a apne critical section ka itna complete kiya phir use cpu se nikal liya gaya क्योंकि शेड्यूल में कोई शेड्यूलिंग एल्गोरिथम थी जिस कारण लेट से राउंड रॉबिन में एक टाइम के बाद तो आपको प्रोसेस खींच लिया जाता है तो ए ने इतना कंप्लीट किया फिर ए को बाहर निकाल दिया गया बी को चांस दिया गया कि आप एग्जीक्यूट कर लो बी अपना काम स्टार्ट किया लेकिन यहाँ पे पहुंच के उसे भी क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे जाना है लेकिन यहाँ पे क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे जब वो कोशिश कर रहा है जाने की ठीक है तो उसे दिया नहीं जा रहा है अब ये कह वो कहोगे कि भाई कितनी देर तक हम चलते रहेगा ये, जब तक उसका टाइम स्लाइस खत्म नहीं हो जाता। जब उसका टाइम स्लाइस खत्म हो जाएगा तो बी तो ऐसे ही शेड्यूलिंग शेड्यूलर उसे बाहर निकाल लेगा, राइट। बी कोशिश कर रहा था कि मैं अपना जो टाइम स्लाइस के बीच में ये क्रिटिकल सेक्शन मुझे भी अंदर जाना है, लेकिन आपको दिया नहीं जाएगा, आपको रोक दिया गया है और उसे बाहर निकाल लिया गया। जब उसका टाइम स्लाइस खत्म हो गया, वो क्या क्या कर रहा है, बार बार उसी लूप में फंस जाता है। आएंगे, विल शो दैट इट विल गो इनटू दिस लूप, गेट स्टक, फिर से कोशिश किया, फिर से स्टक, यही चलता जाएगा। बार बार वो लाइन एग्जीक्यूट करने की कोशिश करेगा और चलता जाएगा, क्योंकि उसे चांस ही नहीं मिलेगा, ए तो खत्म किया ही नहीं है। और जब टाइम स्लाइस खत्म हो जाएगा तब तो उसे निकाल दिया जाएगा सीपीयू से, और ए को फिर से चांस दे दिया जाएगा, और ए फिर अपना ये वाला पोर्शन जो है कंप्लीट करेगा। अब जब वो कंप्लीट कर गया और अगर आप फिर से बी को चांस दे रहे हो एग्जीक्यूट, एंड बी विल कंप्लीट दिस, नाउ बी विल गेट अ चांस टू एग्जीक्यूट द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन। दिस इज व्हाट इज गोइंग टू हैपन। ओके,
Sir,
another
what
question
if the B does not get a chance later on?
आएंगे भाई, आएंगे, जस्ट वेट। सारी चीजें हम हैंडल करेंगे धीरे धीरे, विल टेक केयर ऑफ दैट। सो व्हाट इज द सॉल्यूशन दैट वी आर प्लानिंग? द सॉल्यूशन इज इट हैज टू बी इंडिपेंडेंट ऑफ द हार्डवेयर इंस्ट्रक्शंस ऑफ द नंबर ऑफ प्रोसेसर्स। अंडरस्टैंड दिस, इट हैज टू बी अ वेरी इंडिपेंडेंट सॉल्यूशन। So the solution is like this: you add an additional code before the critical section. Okay, you add an additional code before the critical section, and this additional code, so every process, chahe wo A ho, chahe wo B ho, sare processes ke critical section wale code se pehle aur uske baad aap kuch additional code lagaiye, right? Some additional code has to be there. What is this code? What is this code going to do? Well, this is going to perform some kind of a lock. It will be acquiring some lock and some kind of an unlock. ये कुछ इस तरह का है, आपको एक lock दे दिया जाता है जिसे आप lock करके अंदर जा सकते हैं। अगर आप को चांस दिया गया है भाई आप क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे एग्जीक्यूट कर सकते हो, अच्छी बात है, आप, इसका मतलब है आपके पास वो लॉक है और किसी के पास नहीं है। जितने भी बाकी प्रोसेसर हैं किन्हीं को लॉक नहीं मिला, आपको ही सब मिला। आप वो लॉक लीजिए, अंदर जाने से पहले लॉक कर दीजिए, गो टू द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन, डू योर वर्क, बाहर निकालने से पहले अनलॉक कर दीजिए। यह है काम। तो ये लॉक अक्वायर करना और अनलॉक कर देना, यही एंट्री और एग्जिट सेक्शन की कोड है। अब वो लॉक कैसे होगा, क्या होगा, वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट दैट। इज द कॉन्सेप्ट क्लियर? दिस इज द एडिशनल कोड दैट एवरी प्रोसेस शुड हैव। एवरी प्रोसेस, इफ एवरी प्रोसेस हैज दैट कोड, ऑब्वियसली एवरी प्रोसेस विल हैव अ लॉक एंड एन अनलॉक सेक्शन, एंड द लॉक सेक्शन विल ओनली अलाउ वन प्रोसेस। सेम कोड सारे लोगों में होंगे, सिर्फ एक ही का कोड रन करेगा, इसका मतलब उसको लॉक मिला, और बाकी सारे के जो लॉक वाले में उनका कोड रन नहीं करेगा तो वो फंस जाएंगे, वो नहीं अंदर जा पाएंगे। दैट्स द रूल। देखते हैं क्या होता है। सो दिस इज द बेसिक स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ लॉक अनलॉक। ये दो एडिशनल कोड हमें रखने पड़ेंगे। नाउ दिस एंट्री एंड एग्जिट सेक्शन इज नॉट ओनली वन पीस ऑफ इंस्ट्रक्शन, इट कैन बी मल्टीपल इंस्ट्रक्शन, पूरा एक सेक्शन बन सकता है। वी आर गोइंग टू रेस्ट्रिक्ट अवर अटेंशन टू एल्गोरिदम्स दैट आर एप्लीकेबल टू टू प्रोसेसेस एट अ टाइम। द प्रोसेसेस आर नंबर्ड P0 एंड P1, एंड वी विल बी यूजिंग देम, कॉलिंग देम एज PI एंड PJ, एंड J इक्वल टू I माइनस वन, समथिंग लाइक दिस। ओके, लेट्स सी। This is the first attempt. Simple solution. The processes share a common register called turn. Okay. So common integer variable called turn, which is initialized to 0 or 1. And the rule is like this. let's use a common variable, flag कह लो, turn कह लो, जो मर्जी, एक छोटा सा वेरिएबल है जिसका इनिशियल एक वैल्यू दे दिया गया है, चाहे वो जीरो हो सकता है, वन हो सकता है. अब ऐसा है कि इफ यू आर प्रोसेस नंबर जीरो तो आपका फ्लैग जीरो होना चाहिए, तभी आपको क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में चांस मिलेगा अंदर जाने. अगर आप प्रोसेस नंबर वन है तो आपका फ्लैग वन होना चाहिए, तब आपको मिलेगा चांस अंदर जाने. ये हमने रूल बना लिया. तो अगर अभी फ्लैग की वैल्यू जीरो है तो प्रोसेस नंबर जीरो को चांस मिलेगा, अगर अभी फ्लैग की वैल्यू वन है तो प्रोसेस नंबर वन को चांस मिलेगा, राइट. और इस फ्लैग को जीरो वन करेगा कौन, वही प्रोसेस ही करेंगे, प्रोसेस में ही कोड रहेगा जहां पे फ्लैग को जीरो कर दिया जाएगा या वन कर दिया जाएगा. ये है आइडिया, देखते हैं. सो द स्ट्रक्चर इज लाइक दिस, व्हाइल वन, ये पीआई के बारे में कहा जा रहा है. सो यू आर इन प्रोसेस पीआई. सो व्हाइल टर्न नॉट इक्वल टू आई, दैट मींस इफ यू आर इन प्रोसेस पीआई एंड द वैल्यू ऑफ टर्न इज नॉट आई, इफ इट इज नॉट आई इट कैन बी जे. सो इफ यू आर नॉट आई दैट मींस यू डोंट हैव द लॉक, द वैल्यू ऑफ लॉक इज विद समवन एल्स. So if it is not I, what did we say? If it is PI, the lock should be I. If it is PJ, the lock should be J. So if it is PI, you are looking at the process PI. If the turn is not I, you do nothing. You do no operation. और आप इस लूप में फंस गए, आप इसी में घूमते रहोगे. कब तक? जब तक कि भाई आपका टर्न आई ना हो जाए. क्योंकि आपका कोड जब चलेगा तो इस लाइन को जब एग्जीक्यूट करने की कोशिश करेगा वो हर बार इस वाइल्ड लूप को देखेगा और देखेगा, करे अभी मेरा टर्न तो आई है ही नहीं, तो क्या करना है मुझे, मुझे कुछ नहीं करना है, बस बैठे रहो. तो जब भी प्रोसेस पीआई को चांस मिलेगा, शेड्यूलर जब उसे चांस देगा, हर बार वो इस लाइन पे आके रुक जाएगा और टाइम वेस्ट करता रहेगा जब तक उसका टाइम खत्म ना हो, उसे बाहर ना निकाल दिया जाए, पीजे को चांस ना मिल जाए, ये चलता रहेगा, राइट. That's the rule. तो सिंपल सा लॉजिक है. अगर आप पीआई में हो तो देख लो कि अपना फ्लैग आई है कि नहीं. अगर आई है तो चांस मिला, आई नहीं है तो जब तक ना मिले तब तक बैठे रहो. लेकिन ओके, लेट्स से द टर्न इज आई, तो दिस इज द कंडीशन, राइट. सो आई गेट दैट, ओके. सो अंटिल यू गेट द टर्न नॉट इक्वल टू आई, यू डू नो ऑपरेशन. व्हेन विल यू एंटर दिस व्हाइल लूप? व्हेन द टर्न विल बी आई. So let us say my turn is my let's say the turn was initialized to I. So you are executing PI. So this becomes false. This while loop is false. So you will fall through and you will get into this critical section. In the critical section, you do the critical section updation. जो भी variable आपको मिला है update वगैरह कर लो. बाहर निकल रहे. अब बाहर निकाल जब निकलोगे तो आपका जिम्मेदारी है कि आप दूसरे को help करो. कैसे? आपका तो टर्न आई था लेकिन दूसरा जो है जे वाला वो बैठा हुआ है कि उसका कब टर्न मिले, तो आपको टर्न को जे बना देना है. सो दैट जो दूसरा प्रोसेस अंदर नहीं जा पा रहा था अब उसे चांस मिल जाए अंदर जाने की. सो यू शुड मेक द टर्न इक्वल टू जे, दूसरों को हेल्प कर दो एंड देन रिमाइंडर सेक्शन. सो दिस इज द एंट्री सेक्शन ऑफ योर कोड. And this is the exit section of it, right? Some books you may find it lock and unlock. This is like getting the lock or the entry section. This is the exit section. So in the entry section, you are checking whether you have that lock. Turn is equal to I. If you don't have the lock, keep on looping. No operation. If you get the lock, that is turn is indeed equal to I, you enter the critical section, do the job. When you come out of the critical section, you make the turn equal to J. Is that clear?
Sir, while executing, means when it goes to the while loop, then how does it change that turn equal to I? Because every time it is doing do no op only.
Let us see that.
सर
लेट
यहाँ
अस
पर
सी
डेडलॉक
आ
कंडीशन तो सेटिस्फाई नहीं हो रहा है डेडलॉक
रहा है
वाला।
आ रहा है धीरे 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 या वेरी ट्रू एब्सोल्युटली सो देखा जाए एनालाइज करेंगे रिमेंबर वो तीन सॉल्यूशंस जो जो रिक्वायरमेंट है इट हैज टू बी म्यूचुअली एक्सक्लूसिव इट हैज टू बी प्रोग्रेस एंड इट हैज टू बी बाउंडेड बाय इज इट अ क्रिटिकल सेक्शन डज इट सैटिस्फाई द म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन प्रॉब्लम इट इज
यस सर
बिकॉज
यस सर
इट अलाउज ओनली वन प्रोसेस टू एग्जीक्यूट एट अ पर्टिकुलर टाइम क्योंकि टर्न से डिसाइडेड हो रहा है ना तो टर्न आई है तो पी आई टर्न जे है तो पी जे तो ऑब्वियसली वन प्रोसेस को अलाउ कर रहा है म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन तो है इसमें कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन तो है लेकिन एज मंत्राज वॉज सेइंग इट डज नॉट सैटिस्फाई द प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट कैन यू एक्सप्लेन प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट क्या था प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट ये था इफ अ पर्टिकुलर प्रोसेस wants to execute
even if the second process is not willing to go into execution then also it has to go into execution of the critical one because the turn value will definitely change after
right,
the execution
right but correct let us look at p1 and p2 let us look at p1 and here is p2 let's do that what was the case while turn not equal to 1 okay if turn is not equal to 1 do nothing and then we have cs and then here I will make turn equal to 2 right and then I'll the remainder code what about p2 p2 will check while turn not equal to 2 do nothing if turn is not in loop if turn is equal to 2 you enter cs and while coming out you make turn equal to 1 and the remainder Now let's say P1 does not want to enter critical section. So P1 is either in this portion or this portion. When P1 is getting its chance to execute, P1 is either executing this portion or this portion. It is not executing this portion. But P2, when it gets a chance, is executing this portion. Okay. So let us look at this situation. Let's start with P2. P2 execute ho gaya. P2 ये कोड एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा है उसको एंड बाय द वे टर्न वाज इनिशियली 2 सो लेट अस से P2 स्टार्टेड टर्न वाज 2 दिस वाज फॉल्स P2 एंटर्ड क्रिटिकल सेक्शन P2 डिड व्हाट इट वांटेड टू डू एंड इट केम आउट मेकिंग टर्न इक्वल टू 1 सो P2 एंटर्ड CS विथ टर्न इक्वल टू 2 That's the first thing that happened. P2 updated CS. P2 made turn equal to 1. And then there was a context switch. Okay. So remember the current value of turn is 1. Fine. But the problem is there's a context switch P1 executes. But P1 executes in the non-critical section part. Non-CS. It is not in the critical section. Since it is not in the critical section, P1 does not make turn equal to 2. So P1, there's again a context switch, and P1 comes out, P2 again resumes. But remember, turn has not become 2. So P2 resumes. P2 again executes the non part, and these three lines will again be executed. Let's say. And let us say that P2 wants to enter critical section. P2 enters critical section with turn equal to 2. No. This time P2 will get stuck. Why? Because turn has not become 2. Why? Because P1 did not make turn equal to 2. Why? Because P1 did not execute critical section. Now see the problem. P2, a process that wants to enter critical section, is prevented by a process P1. Which does not want to enter critical section. ये तो होना नहीं था हमने क्या कहा था अगर कोई प्रोसेस क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे नहीं है और कोई प्रोसेस एंटर करना चाहता है उसे बिना डिस्टर्ब किए अलाउ करना पड़ेगा लेकिन यहाँ हो नहीं रहा एक ऐसा प्रोसेस जो ऑलरेडी क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे नहीं है वो प्रिवेंट कर रहा है उस प्रोसेस को जो क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे जाना चाहता है That is against the process progress requirement. Right? That's not allowed. तो ये सॉल्यूशन फेल कर गया, नहीं चला ये.
सर एक बार और एक्सप्लेन कर दीजिए ना.
हाँ
एक बार और एक्सप्लेन कर दीजिए
हिंदी में.
नो सर इन इंग्लिश.
प्रोसेस लेट्स से दोनों प्रोसेस इस तरह से चल रहे हैं, पहले P2 चलेगा, फिर P1 चलेगा, फिर P2 चलेगा, ठीक है. और ये पूरी चीज स्टार्ट हो रही है विद टर्न इक्वल टू टू. तो बताओ P2 जब टर्न इक्वल टू टू लेकर अगर पूरी चीज स्टार्ट हुई, सो व्हाट इज द प्रोसेस, व्हिच प्रोसेस विल गेट अ चांस टू एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन? P2. बिकॉज P2 जब इस अपने एंट्री वाले कोड पे पहुंचेगा तो उसे ये कंडीशन फेल कर जाएगा, क्योंकि यहाँ पे टर्न टू है एंड इट विल एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन. सो क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे वो आएगा और क्रिटिकल सेक्शन एग्जीक्यूट करेगा. बाहर निकाल जब वो निकलेगा, व्हेन इट इज गोइंग टू कम आउट एग्जिट सेक्शन में, ये एग्जिट सेक्शन है उसका, वो टर्न को वन बना देगा, ठीक है, और फिर रेस्ट ऑफ द कोड एग्जीक्यूट करेगा. तब तक P2 को बाहर निकाल दिया गया है, P1 गेट्स अ चांस, शेड्यूल हो गई, P1 को चांस मिल गया. अब प्रॉब्लम है कि P1 जब एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा है, P1 नहीं जाना चाहता अपने क्रिटिकल सेक्शन, वो नहीं एग्जीक्यूट करना चाहता ये कोड. तो P1 अगर एग्जीक्यूट नहीं करेगा तो टर्न टू कभी नहीं बनेगा, राइट? तो ड्यूरिंग एग्जीक्यूशन ऑफ P1, बिकॉज P1 डजंट वांट टू एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन, द टर्न रिमेन्ड एट वन, इट डिड नॉट बिकेम टू, एंड देन देयर वाज अगेन अ कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विच, फिर से P2 को रिज्यूम करने का चांस मिल गया. और लेट अस अज्यूम P2 फिर से क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे एंटर करना चाहता है. इस बार P2 यहां फंस जाएगा, ये कंडीशन ट्रू हो जाएगा उसके लिए, टर्न नॉट इक्वल टू टू होगा. क्यों? क्योंकि टर्न वन बन गया है, बना ही हुआ है, वो उसी ने बनाया था, तब से किसी ने चेंज भी नहीं किया. तो इस कंडीशन में वो फंस जाएगा, वो ये ट्रू हो जाएगा कंडीशन, और वो इस रूप में घूमता रहेगा, कभी क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे नहीं आ पाएगा. ऐसा तो होना नहीं था. क्यों? बिकॉज P2 शुड नॉट एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन, P2 शुड एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन, एंड इट इज प्रिवेंटेड बाय अ प्रोसेस P1 व्हिच डज नॉट वांट टू पार्टिसिपेट इन द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन एंट्री. दिस इज वायलेटिंग प्रोग्रेस. इज दैट क्लियर? तो सॉल्यूशन क्या है?
एक्सक्यूज मी सर.
यस.
व्हाई आर वी यूजिंग 0 एंड 1 वैल्यूज? इफ द लॉक इज एक्वायर्ड देन वी कैन सेट इट टू 1 एंड इट इज नॉट देन वी कैन सेट इट टू 0.
हु विल सेट दैट?
वेयर द व्हाइल कंडीशन इज देयर इन द बिजी वेक, वी कैन चेक यूजिंग द XCH रिकॉल इंस्ट्रक्शन, वी कैन सेट द लॉक टू 1 एंड चेक.
गोइंग टू फार. डोंट गो टू फार. आई एम These things that you are talking about, had they evolved, we are going to come to that. For the time being, is this, do you understand the problem?
Yes.
The one that you are talking about was a solution that we are going to discuss later on. For the time being, let's try to focus on here. Okay, this is the problem, right? What is the solution then? This is algorithm 2. Ek flag se kaam nahi hai. क्यों ना दो फ्लैग यूज किया जाए, अरे कर लिया जाए. सो प्रीवियसली इट वॉज एन वेरिएबल कॉल्ड टर्न, सिंगल वैल्यू वेरिएबल. नाउ लेट अस टेक टू वैल्यूज इंस्टेड ऑफ अ वेरिएबल, लेट्स टेक एन अरे ऑफ टू एलिमेंट्स, और उस अरे के एक एलिमेंट एक प्रोसेस का लॉक, दूसरा एलिमेंट दूसरे का लॉक. So flag 2 and they are flag 0 and flag 1. So now that the single variable solution did not work out, let's try to have an array of two elements and each element is a lock. That's again a shared variable, remember. So the lock is a shared variable, the turn In addition to the critical section, the lock is also a shared variable. Now let's have a look at the process PI. What are we doing here? Now what we are doing is this. We are checking the flag. If you are in process I, you are checking the other flag. That's important. If you are in process P1, you are checking while the flag, okay, let me call the two processes as process 0 and process 1, okay, so that you don't have confusion. So process, if you are process 0, you will check flag 1 is equal to true or not. If you see, so if you are process P0 or PI, whatever, and you want to enter critical section, the first thing you check is this shared flag, flag 1. Is it true? If it is true, you know that the critical section is currently held by some other process. Seedhi si baat. Enter karne se pehle, aap dono flag mein dusre wala jo flag hai, flag 1, uska status check kar lo. Bhai wo true hai? Haan true hai. Iska matlab hai, nahi nahi hai wo. कोई और उसे यूज कर रहा है, समवन हु इज यूजिंग द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन. तो जब तक कि ये फ्लैग वन फॉल्स ना हो जाए तब तक मुझे वेट करना पड़ेगा. व्हाट विल आई डू देन? आई विल चेक दिस कंडीशन, फ्लैग वन इक्वल टू ट्रू, एंड इफ इट इज ट्रू आई लूप. दैट्स व्हाट हैज बीन डन हियर, आई लूप. ओके, वेल इफ इट इज नॉट ट्रू, इफ दिस कंडीशन इज फॉल्स, that means flag 1 is not true. If flag 1 is not true, that means that I am given the privilege to enter critical section. No one is holding that. If no one is holding that, you enter critical section. But before you enter critical section, what you do is you ensure that you do not get disturbed. Aap enter karne se pehle apna lock kar lo, ताकि आपको कोई डिस्टर्ब ना करे आपके एग्जीक्यूशन के टाइम पे. इसलिए अपना फ्लैग ट्रू बना लो, दूसरे का फ्लैग चेक कर लिया, ट्रू दिख गया. अगर ट्रू नहीं है तो इसका मतलब है कोई नहीं है. अब मुझे एंटर करना है, मुझे चांस मिल गया एंटर करना, लेकिन मैं एंटर करने से पहले पहले अपना फ्लैग ट्रू बना लूं सो दैट अदर कैन बी ब्लॉक्ड. ये दो चीजें हैं.
अगर अपना फ्लैग जब ट्रू बनाने की बारी आए तभी कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विच हो गया तो
आएंगे, उस पर भी आएंगे, वही तो प्रॉब्लम है. तो ये हो गया ना, पहले एल्गोरिथम समझ लेते हैं फिर इसमें फॉल्ट्स ढूंढेंगे. राइट, लॉजिक ये था, दूसरे का फ्लैग देखो फॉल्स है तो मुझे चांस मिला हुआ है, मैं एंटर कर सकता हूँ. करो, करने से पहले अपना लॉक पहले सेट कर लो, उसके बाद एंटर करो. तो ये दो लाइन मिला के पूरा एंट्री सेक्शन बनता है. That's what has been written. The first line says that check whether the other process in the critical section. If not, you enter. And before you enter, turn your own flag true. ये करना जरूरी है कि तुम जब क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पे हो कोई और तो डिस्टर्ब ना करे, क्योंकि जब तक आपका फ्लैग ट्रू रहेगा और कोई प्रोसेस क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में एंटर नहीं कर पाएगा. तो ये इंश्योर करने के लिए कि आप और सिर्फ आप क्रिटिकल सेक्शन पर. ओके, राइट, देन यू एंटर क्रिटिकल सेक्शन एंड फाइनली व्हेन यू कम आउट यू मेक द फ्लैग फॉल्स, योर फ्लैग, यू टर्न ऑफ द ओन फ्लैग बिफोर एग्जिटिंग सीएस. ओके, व्हाट डू यू इंश्योर? That others will get a chance. So sirf ye red wala jo portion hai, that's the exit section, and these two make up the entry section. Clear? Now is it seems to be okay? Is it really so? Does it really work? No, it doesn't. Why? I'm showing you with two processes.
Just so if in between, if before just flag 1 equal to 2 and after ending the while loop, if in between if there's a context switch, then in that case, there will be an error.
ये वाला कहानी, दिस इज व्हाट इज गोइंग ऑन. सो इनिशियली लेट्स से बोथ फ्लैग जीरो एंड फ्लैग वन वेयर फॉल्स टू स्टार्ट विथ, बोथ वेयर फॉल्स राइट, इनिशियली बोथ वेयर फॉल्स. एंड नाउ व्हेन flag 1 equal to 2, what is this line? This line is coming in which? This line is coming in process number 0. In process number 0, this is the first line. Checking of the flag 1 equal to 2. So it is checking whether flag 1 equal to 2 or not. So you are running process 0. No, flag 1 is not. Flag 1 is initialized with false. So P0 will enter critical section. And will make its flag true. Okay, but let us assume that before it is making its flag true, there's a context switch. Right? Please understand. The while loop checking has been done, but its own flag has not been made true. यहाँ तक पहुँच गए, checking हो गई. दिख गया कि हाँ मुझे एंटर करना है, मतलब मैं इस वाइल्ड लूप से अंदर चला गया, लेकिन अपना फ्लैग मैंने अभी ट्रू बनाया नहीं है, वो बनाना बाकी था, तब तक कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विच हो गया और दूसरे प्रोसेस पे पहुंच गए, P1 पे पहुंच गए. P1 भी वही वाला लाइन एग्जीक्यूट कर रहा है और उसने भी फ्लैग जीरो को ट्रू चेक किया, उसको भी फॉल्स मिल गया और वो भी क्रिटिकल सेक्शन में अंदर चला गया, पूरा नहीं गया, अभी भी अपना खुद का फ्लैग ट्रू होना बाकी है, फिर वो तो हो ही जाएगा. तो दोनों के फ्लैग वाले जो चेक हैं वो दोनों फॉल्स मिल गए और दोनों ने एंटर कर दिया. अब अगर कॉन्टेक्स्ट स्विच हो गया एंड यू कम बैक टू प्रोसेस P0, व्हाट विल हैपन? P0 विल एग्जीक्यूट द नेक्स्ट लाइन व्हिच इज मेकिंग इट्स ओन फ्लैग इक्वल टू ट्रू. And then there's a context switch again, which means P1 will resume. And what will P1 do? P1 will make its own flag true. Now you see, both the flags have become true. And if both the flags have become true, what will happen? Next time.
So mutual exclusion will not be there. Means both of them will enter the critical section together.
Both of them will enter critical section. That's not correct. Right? That's the problem that we are handling. So this is the problem. Algorithm 3. Isme kya karna hai? Flip kar dete hain. Pehle dusre ka flag check kar rahe the. Phir apna flag, agar wo false mil raha tha, we entered and we made our flag true and then we entered critical section. Let's do the other way around. Let us first, in the entry section, this is the entry section, right? So in the entry section, here we are going to first make our flag true and then check the other flag. Okay. Let's try this solution. Just the two lines of algorithm 2 are flipped. Checking will be done later. First, my flag will be made true and then I'll check the other flag. What do you think about this problem? Will it solve mutual exclusion? Is it allowing mutual exclusion? Yes. Anyone?
No, sir, it will not allow.
Why?
Sir, here there will be a situation when both the flag will be true, then no process will get to enter critical section.
In addition to that, let's look at this situation.
But deadlock ka bhi problem aa sakta.
Yes, it is the problem of the deadlock. Mutual exclusion is satisfied. Why? Because you are alternating that flag. That's okay. The problem is, you know, both of them will become true and next time, no one will come out. You go back to the turn problem. What happens is, look at this situation. Okay, I have written a context switch earlier than that. You start with here. Both of them are false, okay? both of them are false. So what happens? Let's say process number P1 is executing. So P1 will first make flag 1 equal to true. So this will become true and this will become false. And then there's a context switch. And flag 0 will become true. It means both of them will be true. Agreed. So now, before the check is made, both the processes have made their flags respectively true. So what will happen? Both will loop in their while check, in that check of the flags. Go back to this. So what happens? Both of them will keep on looping in this line. Why? Because P1 has made this statement. For P0, this has made flag 0 equal to true. And P1, there was a context switch. And P1, let's say, could only execute this line and has made flag 1 equal to true. And now let's say there's again a context switch. P0 is executing this line now. What will P0 find? P0 will find equal to true. What will happen? No operation. Context switch. P1 will execute. P1 will execute this line. What will happen? It will check flags P0. It will find this to be true. And both of them will keep on looping in this. No one will come out. Why? Because to come out of that loop, you have to go through the rest of the portion of the critical section. Only then you have to reach to the exit section. Only then you will be able to make the turn the flag back to false. But you are not able to come out to the exit section. So you will keep on looping. This is the situation that is, again, that's a deadlock situation. This is called deadlock. What is deadlock? Deadlock is a situation where one process depends on the other process, which in turn depends on the previous process. It's like this. This will depend on this, and this will depend on this. And no one moves. Traffic signal, dekho na? Yahan pe char tarah se roads pe charo gaadiyan aake ek jagah pe cluster ho jaati hain. Koi aage nahi badh paata. That's a deadlock. You are obstructing my path, and I am obstructing your path, and both stay there. That is what is happening. P0 will proceed only if P1's flag becomes false, and P1 will proceed if P0 flags becomes false. But P1's flag will be false only if P1 is able to execute, and P1 will be able to execute if P0 is able to execute. No one is executing. That's the problem. P1 का P0 अगर P1 का flag false है तभी P0 आगे बढ़ेगा. लेकिन P1 का flag false करने के लिए P1 को exit तक पहुंचना पड़ेगा, और P1 को exit तक पहुंचने के लिए P1 को अंदर जाना पड़ेगा, और P1 को अंदर जाने के लिए P0 को allow करना पड़ेगा. अगर P0 तो वहां फंसा बैठा होगा. That's the problem. So it does not allow the progress requirement. So what to do? Situation ye hai. Deadlock bana baitha hua hai. P0 ko false, P0 P1 ke flag pe depend kar raha hai, aur P1 P0 ke flag pe depend kar raha hai. Tie hua hai. So this tie has to be broken. Who will break the tie? एक काम करते हैं, दो फ्लैग से काम नहीं हुआ, दो फ्लैग और एक वेरिएबल ले लेते हैं. लेट्स टेक टू फ्लैग्स एंड द वेरिएबल, एंड हियर वी हैव अ सॉल्यूशन. सो इट्स लाइक दिस, वी आर गोइंग टू टेक दोस फ्लैग्स. सो एल्गोरिथम 3 इटसेल्फ, एल्गोरिथम 3 इज द वन दैट सीम्स टू बी ओके, बट इन एडिशन वी आर ऑल्सो गोइंग टू टेक वन मोर वेरिएबल. And that I will use if I am process PI. I'm going to use this variable, initialize that with a value equal to the one expected of the other process. See, I am making turn equal to J. I am assuming that the other process will be favored. Main dusre ko help karna. Apna wala flag true bana liya. टर्न को मैंने जे ले लिया, I'm assuming that J is the process, that the process J would be entering critical section. And then I'm taking an AND condition to test whether it should be allowed or not. Both should be true. If both are true, then I have a no operation. What does it mean? It means that if flag J is true and turn equal to J, both cases, that means P2 is asking to enter critical section and that it's the flag of that other person is also true, which means you are not allowed to enter critical section. But if any one of them is false, if this is true and this is false, you enter critical section. So what happens is this particular turn is the tiebreaker. This is the tiebreaker. And look, whenever you are in a particular process, you are taking the, you are updating the turn by the value required by the other process. So if you are PI, you are making the turn equal to J. And if you are PJ, you will make the turn equal to I. And the moment you will make the turn equal to I, this will be in this checking, this will become false and you will be entering. You will actually be allowing the other person to enter. So in a sense, whichever process is scheduled last and whichever process touches this turn variable loses the time. So when there was a deadlock, whichever process gets a chance to touch that particular turn last, obviously will lose the tie, because the rule says if it is going to touch the turn, it will turn the turn with the value required by the other process. And immediately the other process, this while loop will become false and will enter. So this is what is the basic idea. The rest, algorithm 3 was perfectly fine. The only problem with algorithm 3 was that it was going into a deadlock situation. So somehow I had to break that deadlock. And I'm breaking that deadlock by using a variable called turn. And that turn is initialized to a value of the other process. So if you are in PI, you are making the turn equal to J. And if you are in PJ, you are making the turn equal to I. And when you are checking whether you should enter critical section or not, you are checking both the flag as well as the turn. And if any one of them is false, you enter the critical section. So obviously, when you are in process I and you have made turn equal to J, that means you are allowing process PJ to enter critical section. Because when PJ will be executing, it's this condition will become false and will enter. So that's the rule. The process that touches the turn last loses the time. This is known as Peterson's algorithm. And this is the one that satisfies all the requirements. It goes through the mutual exclusion problem is preserved, progress requirement is satisfied, and obviously bounded waiting, because you will be alternating between one and process one and two. So there is no problem in that. Is it clear?
Sir, if there are no critical sections in one of the processes, then the process with the critical section would wait indefinitely, you know?
No, then this problem doesn't occur. This no, is but... the problem when you have critical section among all the processes. Then what is the problem? If there's only one process with one critical section, so you don't, this problem does not at all occur.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. Now, so we will, this is the Peterson solution. I'm not detailing out, it's already done. I will end up this lecture with discussion on an N process solution. So far, if you remember, we were already
Sir, at least two processes would have critical section, na? Because it is a shared segment, so at least two people need to.
Yes.
Oh,
sir, I was having doubt in the turn thing. Why are we initializing it with another and that by what is happening.
So that's the idea. Algorithm 3 did not work out. तब सोचा गया कि भाई कैसे वो एल्गोरिथम में प्रॉब्लम क्या थी. एल्गोरिथम वाज परफेक्ट, म्यूचुअल एक्सक्लूजन हो रहा था, प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट में फंस रहा था. व्हाई डोंट वी डू समथिंग दैट द प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट कैन बी ओवरकम, आई मीन प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट कैन बी डन और द डेडलॉक कैन बी ब्रोकन. सो डू समथिंग इन द कोड, लेट्स यूज वन मोर वेरिएबल एंड द प्रोसेस पीआई वुड बी अपडेटिंग दैट पर्टिकुलर वेरिएबल विद द वैल्यू ऑफ द अदर प्रोसेस. That eventually solve the problem and introduce that variable in the check as well. That's it. So it's just
instead of turn equal to turn making equal to j, if you would have made the turn equal to I, and in the while loop also.
No. You get back to the same problem. Turn equal to I takes you to the same problem because you are the idea is that I will favor the other person. Then only it is possible. If you try to be favoring yourself, then you end up into the same problem. You don't get through the solution.
Sir,
this is the logic behind this solution. You should favor the other person. That is why if you are PI, you make turn equal to J. Yes.
So sir, now what is the role of the flag? Now it has no role, na flag.
No, it is a role. It has a role. Flag is for the personal check. And turn is for the other person. That is the reason why there are two checks that I'm going to make. One, flag was already there. Flag, with the flag, you are ensuring mutual exclusion. And with the favor, you are breaking the progress requirement.
Sir, agar flag nikal de, fir bhi to koi dikkat nahi hogi na.
Huh?
Agar hum flag nikal de, flag ko.
Nikal doge, to mutual exclusion nahi ho payega. Flag, mutual exclusion ensure kar raha hai. Aur फेवर्ड या टर्न प्रोग्रेस रिक्वायरमेंट की जो टाई है उसको ब्रेक कर ले. ठीक से सोचो सॉल्यूशन को.
आपको पता है सर, गॉट इट.
सो कुड यू प्लीज टर्न बैक टू द प्रीवियस स्लाइड.
यस.
सो इन दिस एल्गोरिथम, विद द कोड, सो इन दिस एल्गोरिथम P1 रीचेस द क्रिटिकल सेक्शन बिफोर PJ एंड इट टर्न्स द टर्न ई टू J, देन it won't be able to run to its critical section. Isn't that going against progress? I mean, the second problem that you mentioned.
Can you again repeat the question?
Is my voice cracking? I could add my question to the chat.
No, it's okay. You can speak out. No problem. Go ahead.
Okay. So I was saying that let's say PI reaches the critical section before PJ. And then it updates flag and then turn, right? So if it has updated turn to J, then it would not get into the critical section, right?
Let me write that so that people understand. Okay, so let's say you want to say that P1 reaches here. P1 is the one that executes this line. Okay, so P1 has made its flag 1 equal to true, okay, next, and it has made turn equal to 0, okay, then
then it checks the condition on the while loop and the condition turns out to be true.
Flag 0 was initially false.
Okay,
flag 0,
thank you.
Flag 0 was false.
Thank you.
Sir, here if we are making turn is equal to J, then won't the turn would be J for both the processes? So what's the use of turn?
No, it's not turn equal to J for. Oh, come on, guys. This is flag 1 equal to true. That's considered to be P1, right? This is what? Turn equal to 0. Then you are checking while flag J means flag 0 equal to true and turn equal to 0. This is what you're checking, right?
Yes, sir.
So either this will be true or this will be true. This is false. Because why? Because P0 has not started, and it has started with flag 0 equal to false. it has not reached the critical section. When it will reach the critical section, then it will turn its flag 0 equal to false, sorry, equal to true. So presently, this will be false. If this will be false, it means that T1 will enter critical section. How can the turn will be? Turn is used to break the tie. Just think logically. Compare that with algorithm 3, you will get the answer. Algorithm 3, the only modification we make is we introduce a turn, and the turn is updated with the value expected of the other process. Have a look at that and you'll get the answers. Okay. Let us finish up this with a discussion on the n process solution. So the n process solution is that we have so far discussed the solution for two processes. Okay. What about n process?
Sir, for n processes, we can make an array instead of turn as single variable.
ऐसा किया गया था लेकिन वो चला नहीं. आपके ये जो जो आप कह रहे हो ये हमारे बड़े बड़े कंप्यूटर साइंटिस्ट ने दिया था. ये एक तरीका ये है. सो व्हाट दे सेड इज कि आप बड़ा सा एरे ले लो और हर एक के लिए एक टर्न ले लो और फिर वो चल जाएगा. प्रॉब्लम ये हो गई कि एक तो है कि इतना बड़ा ये जो एरे तुम कह रहे हो कहीं पे तो रखना पड़ेगा ना उसको. अब जितने प्रोसेसेस बढ़ते जाएंगे, अब 1000 प्रोसेस हो जाएंगे तो कितना बड़ा लोगे, इम्प्लीमेंटेशन क्या होगा, 1000 बिट का कोई रजिस्टर मिलेगा?
यस सर. हाँ,
ये सॉल्यूशन फिजिबल नहीं है, तो सॉफ्टवेयर से ही सॉल्व करना पड़ेगा. ठीक है, लेट्स सी. वन ऑफ माई यू नो आई एम बिग फैन ऑफ दिस particular person, and he is to me one of the best computer scientists of our era. His name is Leslie Lamport. He is well known for development of a software called, or a language called, LaTeX, which is used for typesetting of documents. How many of you know LaTeX? Have you heard of this term?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, this is a software which is used for typesetting of documents. You need not worry about indent and all. It's kind of a programming language. You start with slash document, you end with markup based language kind of end document. And within that, for anything you would like to have a slash, let's say you want to introduce a figure, you will have like slash figure, give the name of the figure, slash table. So then you compile this entire document and it gives you a PDF with the corresponding text edited. So Leslie Lamport is currently a scientist at Microsoft, and he's been one of the pioneers of, you know, principal scientists who have been contributing in the field of distributed systems, which eventually today's cloud computing and whatever you see, eventually everything started off with from the basic ideas of operating system, and then this has evolved into multi-process environment, whether you talk about cloud computing or whatever, distributed systems. Everything today is all these concepts, the fundamental concepts applied for multiple processes, and Leslie Lamport has immense contribution in that. Dijkstra's, Lamport, Knuth, they are the, you can say, the pillars of modern day computer science. Lots and lots of contribution. What he gave was, he gave an algorithm known as a bakery algorithm, and that was an improvement on the algorithm already proposed by Dijkstra's and Knuth, Donald Knuth, the art of computer programming. He's one of the, you know, father figures of present day computer science. Any algorithm course you take, Knuth is the one whose book is referred to. So what exactly was this algorithm? Algorithm is pretty simple. It's like you go to a counter, right? It's a bakery solution. So why is it a bakery? Remember, it's a now a problem that has to be handled for n processes. It is not a two process solution, n process solution. N processes, and one of them wants to enter critical section. How do you decide? I have given the original article in the supplementary as a supplementary material from the course website. I'll show that. Let me first discuss, and then I'll show the article published in about 1971, I think. This example gave. So what he said is like this. Algorithm is, you think about a bakery. What is a bakery? Well, you go to a canteen, right? And a food court. So you have, so this is the counter where a person who wants to order some food will go here, and the counter will provide you a coupon or a ticket maybe. Let's say today's, even the banks today are, they work in the same way, isn't it? Just a minute, this got closed. Are you able to see this?
No, sir, your screen is not visible.
Yeah,
not visible.
Yeah, now it's visible.
It's visible, right? Okay.
Yes, now okay,
so the idea is this. It's a very interesting solution, and listen to this patiently. So you go to a counter, and that gives you a ticket. Right? How are the tickets given? The one who came earlier will be given a ticket of a value, which is the minimum, right? Suppose you are the first person, then we have four people who are standing in queue. So this person will get a ticket number 0. This will get a ticket number 1. Okay. This will get ticket number 2. This will get ticket number 3. So the person, the ith person, will get a ticket number I, and the next person will have I plus 1, I plus 2 in this way. Agreed? This is the way we give the ticket. So let us assume that this is a bakery shop. You are going to the counter to collect some order, and you are given a ticket at the doorway. So at the doorway, you are getting a ticket, and your ticket number will tell you whether you are going to come in which, I mean, when are you going to get your chance. So one who's having ticket number 0 will get the first chance, then 1, then 2. So the rule is, person with the ticket number of denomination lower will get a first chance. Okay, this is the rule. So initially, all of them will have the ticket value equal to 0. To start off with, everybody is getting initially that initial values will be 0. At the doorway, you get the ticket number. So let us say person number P2 wants to enter. So he gets a ticket number 1. Then we have 4, maybe then 2, 3, in this way, everybody got a ticket and their values were increased. Now, the idea is that when two people who would be getting that particular ticket would like to enter and come to the counter, two people who would like to come to that counter at the same time, one will be prevented. Who will be prevented? The person who has got a lower ticket, a ticket of higher value. That's the rule. Okay. So we started off with a very simple implementation. The implementation is, let's take an array called number. Number of processes is 1 to n. And we are going to take a number I. This is the number, which is the ticket number. You will be getting that. What is the ticket number? Ticket number is 1 plus the max of the current numbers that have been allocated so far. So if you are, let's say, process number P1, P2, P3, P4, suppose you got a ticket number 0. What will P2 get? P2 will get 1 plus max of all the ticket numbers assigned so far. Currently, the max is 0. So 1 plus 0, you will get 1. What about P3, who's coming next? P3 is 1 plus max of all the ticket numbers assigned so far. 1 plus max of 0 and 1, which is 1. So 1 plus 1 is 2. What is the ticket number given to the next person? P4. It is 1 plus max of all the tickets assigned so far. Max is 2. So 1 plus 2 is 3. So in this way, P4 will get the ticket number. Okay, agreed? Now, who will get the chance to enter the bakery? So this is the initial run that you see.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So the ticket number should start at 1 because for the process P1 should get a ticket number 1. We have 1 plus maximum of 0. So P1 will get a ticket number 1 and then P2 will 2. P3 will get 3, P4 will get 4.
So you want to give, okay, I gave the nomenclature in this way. You want to give the nomenclature as something else? Okay, no problem. Okay, you want to give this as P0, P1?
No, sir. From the first line in the code, number of I, that which is the ticket number, the P0 process will get a ticket number 1. Not 0.
True. Oh, so you want, true. Correct. This is like 1, 2, 3, 4. Yes, because all of them started with 0. Correct. Now what you want to do? You want to find out for 1, j equal to 1 to n, okay, which is not equal to I. So you are looking at a process pi and you are trying to find out. Please try to understand. The idea is like this. You are maintaining an array. And for n processes, this is the array that you have, and you have a true flag, false flag for each one of them. It's like 0, 1 type. 0, 0. Initially, all of them are 0. This is the number that you see. Now, the moment you have a particular value as 1, okay, you decide on that critical section based on the and each one of them is having. So this is for P0, this is for P1, this is for P2, for P3, P4, P5, P6, this is it. Okay. And some of them, if they want to enter critical section, will make this 1. Now you want to decide whether between this and this, who will be entering the critical section. So for all the value of J from 1 to N, for all those whose number is 0 or the number is greater than I, when number is greater than the corresponding number of that particular process, okay, we has to wait. So whom will be given a chance to enter the bakery? Either the number which is greater than 0 or which is the minimum among all the others, he will be given a chance to enter the critical section. And anyone whose either the number is 0 or the number is greater than the currently available ticket number has to wait. So this is the meaning. Await is the function which will make to wait if the number is 0 or the number J is greater than number I. This is the code that should run for PI. Now, when I say PI, I actually mean for all processes. So whenever a particular process is checking, it will check its number is the minimum or not. And it should not be 0. That is it. If it is true, you enter the critical section, do your task. But remember, when you come out of the critical section, you make your number equal to 0. This is what you do. Okay. So here maybe P1 is 1 and P1 is, let me write this for the 4 so that you understand. For this one, it will be like this. You have 1, 2, 3, 4. So if these two are checking whether who should enter, so when P1 will check its own code, it will find, is my number equal to 0? No, it is not. Is my number the minimum? Yes, it is. So I should enter critical section. When P4, P3 will check, it will find, is my number equal to 0? No. Is my number minimum? No, because there's already a person who's having minimum number. I should not enter critical section. That's it. But will this be applicable? Will this work? No. Why not? Because it will create a deadlock. When it will create a deadlock, the problem is when you are assigning this number, this is the time when two people can get the same number. Then you are in trouble. Let me show you. This is the situation. What happened is, when you are assigning the number, then two people, they got the same ticket number. And then the check allowed both of them to enter the critical section. And here you see both ticket numbers 2 and 2 are in the waiting position. Obviously, in the next case, they will be entering the CS. Both will enter. This is the trouble. What does that mean? It means that you have to do something to remove this particular condition. So I'm not going into the implementation tool, just we tried to do that using a lexicographic order so that that particular progress requirement can be removed. Lexicographic means in the order in which they come in the dictionary, in the order in which they come. We try to give JJ and II so that you always have a test, but that again does not satisfy mutual exclusion. I'll come to the final solution that actually resulted in, which is given by Leslie Lamport, and it gave you this. We used something called choose, and that was made initialized to true. So you can think about this. Doorway is the part where you are getting that ticket number. And waiting is the portion based on the ticket number you are going to wait so that somebody is currently served at the counter. You will first get the ticket, which is 1 plus maximum. Next, you will make the choose equal to false, very similar to Peterson's solution that allowed myself to be equal to false. And at that waiting part, which is the decision, whether you have to wait or will you be allowed, you will wait if your choosing is equal to false, and wait if the number J, if your number is not equal to J, and your lexicographic order, that is, you have a number which is greater than the other. Okay. So number J and J, it's a tuple, by the way. The number J and the J, it's not only the process, but process number along with its number value. Both of them together would make up this tuple. And by the way, remember, when we are handling this kind of tuple, let's say I say that A comma B is greater than C comma D. Okay, let me write it in the form of ordered pair. A comma B is greater than C comma D. When will this happen? If A is greater than C, or A is equal to C and B is greater than D. That's it. So when then this is greater than this, solve. And even if these two are same, even if these two are same, I will break the tie by taking the one which came earlier as the one which should be given a preference. This is how I break the tie. So instead of taking only numbers, I take a tuple and then I use this along with this condition to prevent anyone from entering the critical section. So I have two rows, choosing and one. This is the bakery algorithm by Leslie Lam. I'll show you the paper and then we'll end this. So are you able to see this?
Yes, sir.
I'll just finish off this with, I've already given the paper. Have a look at that. It's a wonderful paper. And yeah. Are you able to see this? No? Okay.
Awesome.
Let me, okay, just a minute.
It is visible now.
Yeah. So this is the paper that Lamport had published, which mentions the concurrent programming problem. It's for N processes. So it's already there. I'll just read out. Knuth and Debon and Eisenberg and McGuire have given solutions to a concurrent programming problem proposed and solved by Dijkstra's. A simpler solution using semaphores has also been implemented. These solutions have drawback for using two multi-computer system. The failure of a single unit will halt the entire system. We present a simple solution which allows the system to continue to operate despite the failure of an individual component. And the algorithm is this. This is what I explained to you. Okay. And this is the relation that I was talking about, which has been used here, which ensures that even if two processors get the same ticket number, the one which is having lower suffix will be given a preference. So that solves the problem. And this is the algorithm. Go through that and read it and try to read this particular para. Entire thing you don't need. Just the algorithm and the proof of correctness, you'll get to know the actual bakery algorithm. So with this, I end today's lecture.
Sir, can I just make a request?